It's time for the playlist party with your host, Roy Mayorga.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the playlist party. Everyone out there on the interweb, how are you all doing? There are, what do you call it? Put all questions, comments on that little column over there. And yeah, let's get to this show. The show, basically what I'm doing today is I'm just playing five songs that had the most impact on my life as a young kid, young drummer in the 70s when I grew up. First track I like to start with, the one track that really turned my head, and probably the first heavy rock and roll track I ever heard, was a song called Frankenstein by Edgar Winter. There he is. I heard this track probably the first time on the radio. It was 1973. Like, I talked to my brother a couple of days ago about this, like, when exactly was the first time we all heard this, and, you know, all that jazz. Basically, we heard this on the radio. He bought this 7-inch and brought it home, and we just jammed to it. And I remember hearing it for the first time and being like, wow, I never heard anything like this. Because previous to that, the music that I was normally listening to a lot was a lot of Motown music and a lot of R&B and soul music that my, you know, my mom and my dad used to listen to. And, you know, I grew up listening to, you know, stuff like, you know, the Supremes and, you know, Stevie Wonder, you know, Curtis Mayfield, Superfly. That was played around the house a lot. But then I heard this track and it was just like, holy, holy shit. The heaviest sounding track I ever heard. Also, the first time I ever heard a synthesizer. That explains why I have all this crap, and I'll explain to that to you guys later. But yeah, I mean, just between the synthesizers, the guitars, the drumming on that record, I mean, that's such a groove and such a pocket. A drum solo in the middle, man, that just like really, really got me when I first heard it. And also, my brother reminded me that we saw this on television when on the Midnight Special. And I was thinking, like, how did I watch this at 3 years old on Midnight Special, Dan? My brother's name is Dan. He's it's like, yeah, you're probably staying up later. We just woke you up, and, you know, we're in front of, you know, my brother used to like, I guess he used to like staying up late at night watching TV shows like that. And because of shows like the Midnight Special and Don Kirshner and stuff like that, that's how we were able to find out about all this cool, you know, music at the time, you know. So without further ado, let's play this track. And that's Rick Derringer on guitar. Right now you're hearing guitars and synthesizers, just dual leads. It's amazing. It's that synthesizer back there, actually. ARP 2600. There you go. Big synthesizer lead right here. My mind was completely blown watching this. And, you know, later on, once I was a little older and getting the concept of what this thing was, mind-blowing away. The fact that Edgar Winter strapped the keyboard that's connected to that synthesizer around his neck, so he technically was the first guitar player. You gotta imagine, it was 1973, man. This was unheard of, you know? So he went from ARP 2600 to saxophone. This guy, Edgar Winter, is an incredible musician. And the story is, the reason why they call this song Frankenstein is I heard this is like a really long jam, and they basically took the reels tape that they recorded to and edited it down to what you're hearing now. And I think someone made the comment like, wow, this song is like Frankenstein. And that's why the song's called Frankenstein. Here comes the big drum solo. This one totally like got me. Really simple drum solo, very effective. I mean, really cool sounding. I think Edgar Winter was on timbales dealing with the drummer. Pretty cool back and forth here, right here. Right here. Two drummers. Listen to that swing and that sick synthesizer lead, man. Through a wah pedal. All right, big payoff right here. This is where I was like, what the fuck is that? Come on. That guy right back there. Big Phil. Sick. Imagine this song was a single, it was on the radio, an instrumental. It's pretty amazing. All right. Now, that track, man, I mean, that pretty much started me on the path, not only with drums, but with also seeking out the sound of synthesizers. And it's why I have all this stuff here. I love the sound of synthesizers. I love the sound of drums. But I started with drums first, and I acquired this stuff much later, of course, because, you know, it's just impossible to get at that time. So the first like few years of my life, I just was on the drums, and eventually later I started getting more into this stuff, but this is always in the back of my mind. I always love the sound of these synthesizers. I just always love the idea that it's voltage, it's tamed voltage, you know, there's nothing like it, you know? And I mean, there's other bands, you know, that had these sounds in, like Emerson, Lake and Palmer, Keith Emerson, probably one of the best keyboardists, you know, ever. He used to play this giant Moog modular. I used to love the sound of that thing. I think it was just so menacing looking and so insane sounding. He's like, to me, like the god keyboard player, one of the best. So after covering this sound, thankfully to my brother, who steered me in the right direction with a lot of the stuff that I'm into. It wasn't for him, I wouldn't have found out about a lot of this stuff. The next thing that turned my head was Zeppelin. And the first song I think I've ever heard by them was A Whole Lot of Love. And, you know, of course, you know, when you first hear that song, or at least for me, when I first heard that song, it's just the guitars and the vocals. I'm like, wow. And then the drums came in and I'm like, oh my God, mind blown. And just that groove that John Bonham had throughout that whole song, it was just, you know, absolutely mind blowing. And just totally set the, you know, the pace for me of what to look for in drums, you know, and that whole middle section with that breakdown. I always wondered how they did that back then. I mean, I didn't know anything about, you know, delays or crazy echo and any of that stuff. I just couldn't understand how they were doing those sounds, but that song totally, you know, changed everything for me. And then once I got that in, once I took all that in, you know, I finally got to see and hear Song Remains the Same. And, you know, that was around the time a lot of live albums were coming out. You had Kiss Alive and Frampton Comes Alive. You know, I was really into live records, but something about that record, that Song Remains the Same record, was just, you know, just great record. And the one track on there that really got me, obviously, was Moby Dick. I think every drummer loves that track. I mean, that drum solo that John Bonham does on that is just phenomenal. I could listen to that forever. I'll never get sick of that. I know there's many different versions of Song Remains the Same out right now, but my favorite one is always going to be the first version that came out in 76. And that's the one that I'm most familiar with. The edit on that one is actually a lot different to the newer versions that are out. But I prefer listening to that one because that's what my six-year-old ears are used to. Just every little nuance he did in that solo. I've always, you know, tried playing all that stuff and learning. That's how I learned how to play drums, was playing to those records, playing to Frankenstein, playing to Zeppelin. And then, and just took it from there. But after that, the one band that really made the biggest impact as a kid, I mean, just looking at them before even hearing them, was a band called Kiss. That band Kiss, you know, makeup, monsters, playing rock, you know. The first time I ever seen what they looked like was I saw a cartoon version of it, because I watched my brother walk past me with his friends from high school with a copy of Destroyer in his hand. So automatically, as a kid, I'm like, it's all cartoony looking. I'm like, whoa, what is that? So I started following my brother behind him with his group of friends, and as he's about to get into the room to go put this record on, he turns around to me. He goes, "Ah, no, step back, kid. It's to give you nightmares." Close the door on me. And I was kind of like, the hell, man. So I started to cry. So I remember telling my mom, I go, I wanted to hear this Kiss thing. I want to know more about this Kiss thing. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. So then, you know, talk to my brother more about it. And he's like, yeah, Kiss is, you know, you should check out Kiss. You probably like Kiss. He listened to this Kiss stuff. He wouldn't let me hang out with him in his room because he's with his friends doing whatever. So he's like, yeah, you know, I'll get you into Kiss another time. You know? So then one night, when I was asleep, he wakes me up in the middle of the night, like, I don't know what time it was, probably like 11, midnight. Cool brothers do that. Don Kirshner's rock concert was on, and Kiss was on there. I guess they're supporting Rock and Roll Over. Played Calling Dr. Love. They played Hard Luck Woman, I Want You. So that was my first time seeing them on TV. I was like, holy shit. And they were instantly my favorite band after that. For Christmas that year, I got the Rock and Roll Over album. And I just played that thing to death, played drums to that. So between that, Song Remains the Same, the live Zeppelin album, those are the two records that I learned from that year. And then started, you know, going backwards and buying the other records like Destroyer, and then bought Kiss Alive, and then that was it. Kiss Alive, man, that's like the best live album I think ever. You know, a lot of people dispute that, but I think it's the best. I think it's the best Kiss live album. I think it's the best live album ever. I mean, they pretty much raised the bar with live albums. After that, I mean, everybody would make live albums after that. I mean, it was a popular thing. So 77, I did a drum recital at my at the music store I was taking drum lessons at. There it is. Everyone noticed the picture of Geddy Lee behind me. I think that was a Sun Amps ad poster. I remember actually taking that poster after that because I was really into Rush at that time too. I just got into Rush. I'll get into that in a minute. But just got into Rush around that time. I'm like, gotta have that poster. So this is 1977. I chose to play King of the Nighttime World. I chose that song because to me at that time was probably the hardest one to play because it's a constant 16th note drum roll throughout the whole song, except for like the verses, regular straight, you know, rock beat. But then the whole thing is just, I just thought it was a cool song. I love the way it sounded. I loved the power it had when you first heard it. And also remind me the time, the first time seeing them also on the Paul in Halloween special show that they were on. And they opened up with that song or Detroit Rock City. I think it was this song. And I just remember just like jaw to the floor, like, oh my God, it was the best. You had Paul in, funny motherfucker. The funniest guy ever, in my opinion. I think I love Paul. And you had the Wicked Witch from Wicked Witch from Wizard of Oz hosting the show with Witchy Poo from H&R Puff and Stuff. It's, man, it was, you guys got to watch that. Just look it up. It's great. The footage is amazing in it. I know they lip synced it, whatever, but I didn't think that as a kid. I thought they were actually really playing. But the performance that they make for those songs on that show, it's, every time I watch it, it's like, wow. You see Gene like jump like 6 feet in the air with his bass, like just landing and just smoke, fire, all that, you know, blah, blah, blah. Tripping over my own words because I'm so excited thinking about it. Anyway, I played King of the Nighttime World. That was the first time I actually performed in front of people. Yeah, let's play it. See? It's great. Still love it. Everything about this song to me is perfect. It's so sad living at home, far from the city, and the midnight sun is so bad. Going to school, so far from me, and the dirty things that we do. I'm the king of the nighttime world, and you're my head night queen. I'm the king of the nighttime world. Come live your secret dream. It's so fine. Love it with ease. If I'm not mistaken, I think Kim Fowley helped write this song. Being with you, being with me, makes everything alright. I'm the king of the nighttime world. And you're my head night queen. I'm the king of the nighttime world. A secret tree, all right. I love Peter Chris's playing on this record, on this song especially. He had a really, really cool style, man. Kept it simple, played for the song. I mean, I do like my technical drummers too that have a little more flash too, but these songs didn't need anything like that, you know? It reminds me of getting ready for school. Looking at my drums like, I'm going to play you later when I get home. Yeah, I would come home every day after school and get on those drums and just put these Kiss records on and blast those two speakers right at my head like I still do today. Yes, he is the king. That was the king of the nighttime world. Yeah. To, you know, just the memory, just listening to these, to that song, I could just, like I said before, I could remember, I can remember just, you know, getting up for school, looking at the drums as I'm combing the hair, looking at the Kiss poster on the wall and be like, I want to be that. I want to do that when I get older. And just come home and take my brother's speakers from his stereo system and point them up at me like, you know, like you do monitors in a live situation. I had no idea, you know, that's what I would be doing later. But I just instinctively put those two monitors down here, faced them up, and just cranked that stereo that we had as loud as it can go. It even distorted a little bit. But it sounded great, and it matched the volume to my drums somehow. And I used to play to the Kiss Alive album a lot, especially more than these records, only because I wanted to feel like I was playing in front of an audience. I wanted that feel, and always dreamt and imagined that I was Peter Criss playing all these songs with Kiss. And yeah, it's a good memory. I can remember doing that. And when I would stop playing, outside my window, there'd be these gang of kids. Now you're just, ah! I get up and I turn around, look out the window, and it's like six of my friends from around the corner hearing me play drums. I'm like, wow, that's so cool. And I'd go downstairs and they're like, we didn't know you played drums. I'm like, I go, yeah, what are you playing to? I go, Kiss. They're like, what the hell is that? Come over here, guys. So I showed them all the records. And, you know, at that time, these kids didn't, you know, these kids were more, they weren't really into music. A lot of my friends were more into just, you know, riding their bikes and collecting cards and whatever, you know. I was in my room playing drums, but I would go out and play, of course. That picture, that's from 1979. At that time, I was playing a lot. Excuse me. I got this weird thing in my voice. Okay. 1979, that picture. At that time, I was playing to a lot of Rush and the Police. That was a more technical side of things that really got my ear. The first time hearing Rush, I mean, my brother brought home the Farewell to the Kings album, and we were just like blown away. Like, who is this guy? Who is Neil Peart? Oh my God. I never heard anything like that. And I've never heard any kind of drumming like that. It was like so grooved, so much pocket, but so much technical and flash in there, like, and crazy off time and polyrhythm stuff like that. I never heard anything like that. You know, listening to songs like, you know, Cygnus X 1, I think is probably still my favorite Rush song to this day. You know, I can remember sitting down trying to play all that stuff and trying to figure it out. I mean, at that time, there was no videos or any like that, so I couldn't really see what Neil was doing. I could only hear, so I could just try to mimic it. And then the other record that really got me, that my brother brought home, was All the World's a Stage. There's one track on that, man, probably one of the best drum solos. And that's the Working Man song, Working Man Live. I mean, I was like, how on earth is he doing? How's he doing all this stuff? And I'm like listening really closely. Like, it's a lot of crazy double bass stuff on there. And there's this one thing he does that I remember when I first got it, I was just like, ah! It was the, there's a little break in there in the solo where it's like, ah! That's the coolest sound. That was the coolest drum thing I think I ever heard at that time. And I kept doing it over and over and over again. It's driving my brother nuts, everyone nuts. But yeah, that song kicks ass. Listen to it right now.
We'd like to take you back to our first album and do something. This is called Working Man.
Oh, there's a lot of cowbell stuff in there that he was doing that I just thought was genius. I love that. I love the cowbell. He's the only guy to get away with playing the cowbell. Neil, you play a mean cowbell. He plays a that whole setup. That Slingerland drum kit, man. Oh my god. Yes, more cowbell. And I remember even after hearing the cowbell, like as it was played on this track, I'm like, okay, I need to go out and find cowbells. And I can remember from that picture in 79, right after that picture was taken, my neighbor underneath me was moving and he had a bunch of drums and a bunch of hardware with a bunch of little cowbells. So before he moved, he gave me all the rest of his hardware, because in that picture that you see from 79, I just have that with the drums and one cymbal. He gave me three stands and one hi-hat stand. And I was like, fucking great. I didn't have a hi-hat until I was nine. So I was doing everything between the crash cymbal and those four drums. That was it. You know, even to this day, the core of my drum kit is still the four drums and the one crash cymbal up here. You know, everything else is just add-ons. So get back to the cowbell part. He had a whole mess of these little cowbells. He had it was a Ludwig cowbell. And actually, it was a Ludwig cowbell, a Pearl cowbell, and a couple little weird cowbell bell things, like the little ones. And there was like five of them. And it was almost kind of like the same sizes and setup as what Neil had on this record. So I took those ties that you put around, you know, pipes, like, you know, like radiator hoses, and I just clamped all of those cowbells to the one cymbal stand. So I had a whole tree of cowbells like Neil did, and I used to try to perform this drum solo with that. I wish I still had those things. And I forgot to mention, with that hardware that my neighbor gave me, he gave me all these other cymbals too. Like I have like a pair of 13-inch hi-hats, and two crash cymbals and a ride. And those cowbells. No, they weren't zip ties. I don't think those existed yet. Alex Lifeson killing it. Phenomenal. It's a great live track, man. It's so of the moment right there, captured, you know what I mean? I can remember just like staring at this record and on the inside of it, just looking at all the pictures as this album was playing and just be like, man, so like in awe. I still am when I look at it, when I listen to it. Yeah, this is one record I always go to the most because of all those memories and remembering hanging out with my brother in his bedroom listening to this like full volume, just be like entranced into Rush. Absolutely three of the most hardworking guys in rock, one of the best. I love how they made a medley. They went to this song and then back into Working Man, then the drum solo. It's genius. It's the cowbell. I just want to get to this drum solo part. Jules, can we go to the drum solo? I'm gonna go, I just want to point out the parts that I was just like, drum solo, please. Anybody feel free to send anything on the little chat line, questions, whatever. If there's anyone out there. Is Sabian going to release my signature ride? I don't know. But, I mean, if you want one, you can custom order them. Custom shop. There's a couple 22-inch versions out there. A couple people hit me up saying they have 22-inch versions of my ride. I haven't heard that one yet, but I heard it's pretty cool. But the true sound of it is a 24-inch. Well, I feel the drum solo coming. It's coming. I wish I could show like an inner gatefold picture of that record that's up right now. There's some really cool pictures, live shots in there. It's coming. Yeah, Neil's playing on this song is so great, man. So amazing. So much power. Here it comes. Comes in with the biggest, insane drum fill into this drum solo. It's so amazing. From the top, Tom. Guitar. Here comes. Snare drum. My mouth. Jaw drop. 9-year-old kid going, how the fuck am I gonna do this? Well, I figured it out. Tried. Cowbells. Thank you. Oh man, I can't hear it. Comes another cowbell part. Uh-huh. Splash. Yeah, after hearing this, I was like, okay, I need cowbells. I need higher concert toms. I got to get this stuff. There it is. Just a cool break there in the middle of that drum solo. Quads for days. That part right there, I used to love the sound of, you could hear the ambience of the room open up the slower he got on the drums. I just thought that was the coolest sounding thing ever. Still do. Oh, and the bass shifter flanger on drum solos, all about it. Listen to that. What that probably was probably the Mutron biphase, which I heard a lot of on the house sound engineers used to like to use at live. Peter Criss drum solo during God of Thunder. Moby Dick, of course. The drum there's that room ambience again. Big cowbell moment. Ooh, there it is. All right. Big rock ending, man. Best. Powerful. Mm-hmm. Man, still get chills when I hear that track, man. I just gotta say thank you, Neil, for teaching all of us. You are badass. Thank you, Rush. So I think there's a picture of that sleeve. Is there a picture of the inner sleeve? There it is. Can you make that a little bigger? Okay, I guess not. There's a couple shots in there that I always thought were really cool. Let me see, there it is. There's one all the way at the lower left of black that I always thought was great. My left, not yours. yeah, there it is, black and white one. Such a cool shot. All those shots. That'd be a really cool poster. Just like that. What do you guys think? What do you guys think of Working Man? What do you guys think of that track? Anyone? Anyway, I love it. So, there you go. Next track, The Police, Message in the Bottle. Now, what do I say, man? Some of the best hi-hat work, some of the best drumming I've ever heard. I mean, Stuart Copeland, I mean, he's well known for his hi-hat work. Between him and Neil Bonham, Peter Criss, pretty much full spectrum, the spectrum is covered there. You know, you learn your groove from John Bonham. You learn your simplicity and keep it, you know, keep it solid with Peter Criss. You learn your technicalities, your technical way and pocket as well from Neil Peart. And you learn this crazy hi-hat work from Stuart Copeland. I mean, the first time I heard this record, this song on the radio, I was like, man, I never heard anything like it. It was almost like had this punk rock kind of vibe to it, but also had this reggae feel to it as well. It's another thing of music, another genre I discovered through this band as well, discovering punk and reggae, you know, led me to, you know, finding out about Bob Marley, you know, Burning Spear, stuff like that, led me to finding out about Devo, and that opened up, you know, me finding out about the Ramones and the Sex Pistols and the Clash, you know, and then to Joy Division, to Killing Joke. Like, this is all within that year, you know. But this track, man, this track really, really, really did it for me when I first heard it. I mean, the whole album is great. I mean, the Bed's Too Big Without You, Bring on the Night. There's some great drumming on that. I mean, probably the best. And it still holds to this day. I mean, I listen to it still. And when I hear it, I still get the same feeling. It still feels fresh, you know. I still, you know, practice and play to those tunes because I just love playing them, you know. It reminds me of that time too, just discovering them and figuring out how to do it and how to have this syncopation, you know, figure out syncopation. Because by then I was just playing just, you know, just really forward. But this really opened up, you know, that world for me more in that kind of playing. So let's hear this track. Sick groove, man. Oh yeah, seeing Stuart Copeland set up at that time, I thought was really cool. I always loved his three rack toms across, and those octobons on the side. You know, always loved that sound. And one of the reasons why I play octobons is because of him, because of these tracks. Not octobons, rata drums. Sorry. On the side stick thing, something I love to do still. I actually do that particular kind of pattern in a bunch of Stone Sour songs. I've always tried to incorporate that particular rhythm in anything I've done in the last 30 years. Even in my first band, Nausea, if we do this song that kind of goes on a more police reggae kind of vibe, or I do something like that. The first time I brought something like that into a band like that, I can remember the guys in the band turning around looking at me like, oh, that's pretty cool. I'm like, yeah. For Copeland. There it is. You know, I'd love to ask Stuart Copeland what inspired him to get that particular rhythm, that pattern. I'm sure it's inspired from reggae, but it's just a faster version. It's just pretty, it's just a cool pattern. It's a very signature Stuart Copeland pattern. When you hear that, you know it's him. Between the ride cymbal work he does, the hi-hat work he does, the side stick, you can spot him a mile away with that. There it is. I mean, I could have picked so many other tracks that he's done that I really love, but this track I picked because it was the first one that I heard. And it was the one that I was most obsessive with as a 9-year-old. After this record, Zenyatta Mandata came out, the third album. That's the one that I liked a lot, especially. There's an instrumental song on there called Another Way of Stopping. I think it's like the last song on the record. And it's just like an aggressive police track and some of, like, I think one of Stuart's best drumming. It's great. Yeah, Zenyatta I really liked a lot. I think Zenyatta Mandata and Message, Regatta to Blank are probably two of my favorite albums by the Police. And I still play those two back to back regularly, just to get inspiration, you know. Like, he's got that, like I was saying before, it's his signature sound, the hi-hat, the ride cymbal, the side stick work, you know. And through the Police, I discovered cool bands like the English Beat and, you know, the Specials and a lot of ska stuff, you know what I mean? Like, that was surrounding their name in magazines, especially. Magazines like Cream, Hit Parader, Circus. Like, I would collect all these magazines and find out about all these other bands that are within the scene that they all came from. And like I said, it opened up the door to, like, discovering Devo and, you know, the Ramones and the Clash and, you know, Killing Joke, Joy Division, you know, stuff like that. Yeah. And so that pretty much covers my life as a kid and all through the 70s. But there's so much other stuff that I was into later on. Like, in the 80s, I got more into the more underground music, more punk. Listen to a lot of, like, bands like Discharge and GBH, stuff like that. And listen to a lot of, you know, the American punk and hardcore, like the Circle Jerks and Black Flag and DRI. That's more when I was like 13, 14 years old. I started playing in punk rock bands. My first band was Youthquake. I was 16 years old. There I am. This is outside of one of the couple gigs I did. As you can see, I have a bundle of mismatched sticks. So basically, I just kind of held on to whatever I had and utilized whatever I had. And it looks like I have a piece of duct tape over my finger there because I kept ripping my blister open. That was a really hot show. I remember that. That was at a place called the Roaring Twenties. At that time, I lived in Pennsylvania in a place called Allentown. Lived there for a few years. I was in a place called the Lehigh Valley. Put that picture back up. Help me explain things better. Thanks. Where was I going with this? So yeah, that was in Pennsylvania. That was probably like somewhere in summertime by the looks of it. Yeah, we played this place. A lot of spots to have hardcore punk rock shows then. I mean, you pretty much put them up wherever, whenever you can in a place like Allentown. You had VFW halls. You had recreational centers at playgrounds, like this place called West Caddy Playground. West Catasauqua is another town in Lehigh Valley outside of Allentown. This club, Roaring Twenties, was actually a strip club from what I remembered at night. But it was one of the only places around that would let us have shows too. And this is in South Bethlehem, if I'm not mistaken. So yeah, you just kind of did it where you can, you know, or kids parties or whatever, you know, basement parties. Eventually, there was another place called Oliver J's that opened up, like a proper place for us to have shows at. We used to do shows there too. And eventually after that, I moved to New York City in like 88 or 89. I'm from there originally. And in my mind, I wanted to get back there to continue on playing music and just, you know, to see what's out there and get back, you know, because around 86, 87, around that time, I used to go up to New York and watch shows and go to CB's or the Ritz or whatever. And eventually I was thinking in my head, I'm like, yeah, I want to get back here. I want to live here and dive into music here. And I did. And I moved up there and joined a band called Nausea. Not there it is. This is actually a picture from 1991. I was on tour in Europe. I'm not sure where in Europe this was, but this was sent to me a few years ago. And it was definitely from Europe for sure. Was that backdrop we use there. And those aren't my drums. Oh yeah. Back then, we didn't bring anything. I basically used a different drum kit every night from the opening band. So I had to acclimate to a different kit every night. That was fun. I didn't know any other way. I mean, I didn't know about, bring your drums or this and that. We didn't have that kind of money or budget. We had to buy our own tickets to get there. And the shows were booked. We would sleep on floors. We would sleep in, you know, and play these squats in all over Europe, all these punk rock squats. It was great. It was a great experience. Definitely challenging at times, you know, but I have no regrets. I would never change anything about how that went down. I loved every minute. It was probably one of the best times of my life. But yeah, getting back to Nausea. Nausea was the first band I made my first proper record with. It was the first band I toured with. So it was a big deal for me. Coming to Europe for the first time with them was, I mean, I never imagined I would ever be there, first off, and get to see the things that I've seen that I've only seen in books and, you know, saw a lot of places, you know, that you would see in history books. I visited all these, like, you know, churches and stuff and, you know, all these different places, you know. Hang on. I don't know where I'm going with this. But yeah, saw a lot of great stuff. Seeing Europe change definitely between now and then. There's a lot of things different. I mean, back then I can remember currency. All countries had their own currency. Now it's just euros, obviously. But back then it was like to see different money. It was pretty awesome, you know, and seeing like different, you know, street signs in different languages, and you know, it was great, you know. Saw a lot of great bands, met a lot of cool people. I'm still friends with a lot of people that I met back then. I'm still friends with them now. I still see them whenever I come over there now. Yeah. Any questions? Oh, what's this? Oh, yeah. I forgot. There's one other band There's one other band that really got me. That's not drumming, but the band called Kraftwerk from Germany. They're definitely one of the reasons why I own all this stuff back here. The biggest reason. I love synthesizers. The first time I ever heard them was in 1977. They had this song called Trans-Europe Express. I never heard anything like this. I'm like, how is this so perfect? The drums are so perfect. And what's that sound? It's nuts. Never heard anything like it. Because at that time, the only other electronic music I heard, which I thought was great too, is a song called I Feel Love by Giorgio Moroder. I think it came out around the same year, maybe a year before. But this was even weirder than that, because the vocals were so monotone and so Trans-Europe Express. It was really monotone and just really dark sounding. The whole track was, and I was actually sort of scared of it, but I loved it. And my brother and I were just like, wow, this is great. And he bought the record. I remember when he brought that home too. And I'm like, this album is amazing. Like, they're all playing this like by hand. You know, there was no computers yet. There was no MIDI. There's none of that, you know? Again, still, we didn't understand what they were using and how they were doing it, you know, until a few, you know, years later, when there was more pictures of them with their gear and their equipment. But yeah, this song, I mean, and it was all live too, from what I heard. The one thing that isn't played by hand though is there's a counter rhythm in there. It goes that's constant, but the drums are played manually. Everything's played manually. The drums are actually, from what I saw and what I learned later, it's a Maestro King drum machine that they took apart, and they made these drum pads, and they took those drum pads and they used that to trigger the drum machine. They did this before anybody even had the idea. They had an engineer friend that I guess helped them with modifying synthesizers or whatever to do what they wanted it to do. So they basically were the first ones to make a drum pad, that electronic, you know, drum. So check this out. That's right, Carl Bardos and Wolfgang Fleur. Yeah, those are the guys. Wolfgang Fleur was the first drummer to Kraftwerk. Carl Bardos came in on the fourth album or third album, which is Radioactivity, which is a great album too. That thing. This synthesizer here. Hang on. You can hear a lot of that. Not so much on this track, but on a lot of the record you can. That's a synthesizer that Florian Schneider used to play a lot. He's also the one that did all most of the vocoder stuff too. It's pretty cool. Think about it. It's 1977. Nobody was doing this yet. This inspired so many musicians, so many artists. I mean, people like Gary Numan, Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark, John Fox, Ultravox, Depeche Mode. You would have a lot of that stuff if it wasn't for these guys. Leave Paris in the morning. T-E-E. Bowie, Iggy Pop. Express. Trans Europe Express. Trans I'd love to see you do that, Jason. You shared it with the video of that, it'd be great. Some of those synthesizers they had on this track, I mean, the main string sound you're hearing is this synthesizer, well, not real synthesizer. It's a playback thing, it's called an octagon. And it was these clear discs that had all the sounds on them, and you shove them into the keyboard, and you have these sounds, like that string sound you're hearing, which is crazy. I guess it's like another version of the Mellotron. For those of you who don't know what a Mellotron is, it's basically it's all tapes on each key. You can have strings, you can have choir, but this is on a plastic disc. It's so wild. So yeah, the two drummers in this band, between the two of them, one would be playing kick and snare. The other one would be doing what you're hearing right now, that other weird counter rhythm. Or he would switch to bass keyboards. That would be Carl Bartos and Wolfgang Furr. Ralph Hutter is the singer. Florian Schneider is the other keyboardist. Slash vocoder guy. All right, you can fade out on this.
From station to station, back to Düsseldorf City, meet Iggy Pop and David Bowie.
This song goes for like 13 minutes. I don't want to put you guys through all that. But it's a great track. I mean, that whole album as a whole, to me, is great. There's three records that from that time, back to back, that they made that I think are essential. Radioactivity is the one that's on before this record, and the one after is Man Machine, and then there's another one, actually there's four records, there's another one called Computer World. Those four together to me are like gold, and pretty much what set me on the path with all these synthesizers, you know, between that and Frankenstein by Edgar Winter. I can actually demonstrate that. I was messing around last night firing this synthesizer up. This synthesizer is from 1971, by the way. This is almost 50 years old. It's like the one that Edgar Winter played. I have the sound that he makes in that crazy bridge at the end before the ending of the song. I'll like demonstrate for you right now if you don't mind.
Give me a nod if you guys can hear me. Can you guys hear me? Yes, no? Great. All right. Ready for this? Here it is. This is how he did it. Yeah. Love that thing. But that's not all that can do. That can do so much more. I mean, that synthesizer you can hear on so many records. I mean, especially on all of the early Mute Records release, the Daniel Miller, who's the guy that runs Mute Records, and he also was a producer and did a lot of tracks with bands like Fad Gadget and Depeche Mode. He primarily used that synthesizer for all the sounds, for percussion sounds. That makes a great kick drum sound. You can hear that all over Depeche Mode and Fad Gadget. But this other synthesizer here, that's another synth that Kraftwerk use a lot on those four records I was talking about. And this one is this one. I don't know if you guys can see this. Hang on. This one I really, one of my favorite ones. That is a Prophet 10. And for those who don't know what that is, this synthesizer, you can hear it all over Halloween, Halloween 2, The Fog. No, not The Fog, but Halloween, Halloween 2, Christine, Escape from New York, all those John Carpenter films. Him and Alan Howarth used this synthesizer to make those soundtracks. This thing is a beast, and it sounds evil the minute you hit a key on it. It's just a really great sounding synthesizer. I mean, this is about 40 years old, this synthesizer. Again, like, I've wanted this since I found out what it was, and those movies really really got me into this sort of sound as well, you know. So between that and the bands I just mentioned, that's what makes me who I am today. What else can I say? Yeah. Now what? I'm just going to stand here. Yeah. If you want to get a hold of me, that's where you go. And there. And check out the next episode, January 19th, 10 a.m. with Gergo. Oh, thanks. You just took the, thank you. Now I can't read it. Thank you, Gergo Boreal. Thank you very much. So yeah, and that's my story. I just want to thank you all for spending this time with me and letting me tell you about what I've been through, what I've seen, what I've done, what I've heard. Yeah, and I hope we all have a happy new year. Goodbye, people.